Hi guys, welcome to this week's tutorial. So this week I'm going to be focusing on the noses of domestic animals. So starting off with the snout of a cat, then the snout of a dog, and then the muzzle of a horse. The reason I picked these animals is because if you're going to get into drawing commissions of animals, these would probably be the most common domestic animals that you would be drawing. So I am going to try and structure the next few tutorials around this idea of focusing on different points or parts of domestic animals. So the tutorial after this is going to be on how to draw the sheen or the shine on the coats of animals. And then the one after that, I'll focus on the eyes. So I'll do an eye of a cat, an eye of a dog, an eye of a horse, and an eye of a parrot. And then by combining all these elements or these tutorials later on, you will be able to confidently put them all together, I think, because those are the main things to get right. And then the rest sort of flows from that. So the first one is of a cat. And the reason I picked these photographs is because it shows a lot of detail in the nose. So you're gonna get an idea of the texture, you're gonna get an idea of how to do the surrounding areas of the nose, and you are going to get an idea of how to layer those various colors. So I picked the colorful, most textured, and most challenging, I think, pictures that I could choose so that I can try and focus on all the aspects of possibilities that you might face in your drawings. So starting off with the cat. Okay, so I am using the etching tool to scratch out all those areas in the nose that I know is gonna have a texture. I'll put a link to this video right on the top right here somewhere, to the tutorial that I placed on YouTube on how to get perfect whiskers every time. So this is the same concept with, for those of you that might be new to my channel, the same concept as just using the etching tool to scratch out the texture in your paper, because when pencil goes over that, it doesn't go in the indents of the paper, so it leaves that highlighted. So those little white hairs that you see around the nose, I'm particularly making sure that I scratch them out very well, because they are very highlighted white hairs and you want that to have a nice texture. Make sure though, when you scratch them out in your paper, that you aren't scratching everything in the same direction, because you don't want it to just look like straight lines. You want to do some of them going a little bit to another direction, so just make some a little higher than others and give it a sort of variation, because pay attention to your reference and you'll notice that everything isn't going in the exact same direction, so you want to make sure that it's got a realistic flow. So all I'm doing now is I'm taking my cinnamon color in my Polychromos pencil, and I am adding a little bit of a darker shadow over the nose. So I'm not going too dark yet, but I'm trying to pinpoint the areas that are going to be dark and the areas that are going to be light. And you can see as I'm putting the color over that already those etching marks that I put in the paper are starting to come through, because the pencil isn't going in there, so it looks like it's highlighted. It looks like there's texture on the nose without me having to physically do that texture with my pencils. It's already there for me, which makes it very, very easy. So now I'm coming over with darker colors. There we go, that's much easier for you to see. So always paying attention to my reference photo and making sure I know where the shadows and everything are. Now, I again am not too fussed about the exact colors. As long as it's close, I'm not too worried about the colors being spot on. So that's why I'm not using my swatches. But if you want to get the colors as close as possible, feel free to use your swatches. I've also gotten to the point where I feel a little more confident in my color selection, so I'm not too worried about those details. So using a very, very dark gray, I think it's a cold gray something, I'm filling in those darker shadows. Always using a light hand, never use a heavy hand, and you can see the texture of that paper. So I've zoomed in as much as I can and you can see the texture popping out quite nicely. So on top of the nose, those fine little white hairs in random directions, it's all just gonna make it so much easier later down the line. So continue with my dark shadow. Now I'm using my black Prismacolor because I know that that area in the nose is going to be extremely dark. So I'm happy to start putting in those dark indications right now. So that when you're doing a section like this where it's quite blurry, so that eye over there is quite blurry, you want to make sure to not get any sharp edges. So make sure you use a light hand and don't worry about getting a very sharp smooth edge, because if you do that, it's just going to make it not so blurry. So when we start adding more colors around the eye, we're going to soften those edges a lot more and we aren't worried about any detail. So now I'm just trying to pinpoint all the darker areas in the fur, even in the sort of blurred background area. I'm coming in now with my white Prismacolor pencil. So this is my white wax base pencil. And I'm going over those areas that I know are going to stay completely white all the time. So now I'm adding a little more color to the nose. Making sure I use a light hand. Covering a lot of the area. So even if you cover a bit more of the area than you intend to with the color, once we've blended with the solvent, it will be soft enough for you to go in again with a lighter wax-based pencil. So we can enhance those highlights even more later. So the texture of the nose, you can see the indents on the paper, and I later on want those to be a little more rounded. So towards the end, I am going to use my white wax base pencil to enhance those highlights and make it a little more rounded than what I've gotten on the etched part of it. So you have two ways of doing it. You don't have to etch your paper at all. What you can do before you put color down is use your white wax base pencil and firmly push the white areas into your paper, or firmly draw the white areas with your white wax base pencil, because you'll notice that if you use your white pencil first, white wax base pencil, so Prismacolor or your Caran d'Ache Luminance, if you use that for first, the other colors aren't really going to go over that unless you press really hard. So you can still keep those areas really light and highlighted if you go in with the white first before layering with any color. So now I'm going to blend with the solvent very lightly, and this is going to just help show exactly where my areas of shadow are, and then I can concentrate on details a little later. Now I have had one of my patrons ask me to explain the concept of underpainting, and I think I'll do a YouTube video on this as well, but an underpainting is pretty much your first layer of pencil. That's all it is. You're putting your base layer down to show yourself exactly where the different values are. So you are very lightly using your pencil to put in the different areas of color. So it's your first light layer of pencil and colors that you are using to help you show what's going to happen next. So that is my underpainting. That's on the paper now is my underpainting. And that is just the first layer that's going to show me roughly where the areas are that I'm working on. And then with the underpainting like this, it makes it easier for you to work in sections if you want to, because you know exactly where the different values are, and then you can focus on adding more detail to that later. So what I did now before I put any of this pink color down is you would have seen me use my white wax base pencil, and I just went over the areas that are supposed to be very white. Now the reference photo, the areas of white are whiter than my paper, so I'm trying to press firmly with my white pencil to get it to look whiter than the paper. Okay, so and then after that I just carried on with the pinks in the ears using a light hand, just layering on top of each other all the time. That's all you're doing. So notice that there's a lot of pinks on the right side, but there is almost no pink on the left. There's a lot of light coming from the left side, so that's going to be very white, and you're going to come in with your very light grays. But most of the right side of the cat has a lot of different values of pink. So blocking them in lightly. And then the more I cover the area with a pencil, the more you're gonna notice those whiskers pop out. And that's just gonna make it look more three-dimensional. So with the eye, also just covering most of the area with the grays, adding lighter values of pink. And then that's just the layering process. That is the that is how you start working your underpainting. So you saw what the underpainting was before, and then this is where you start working the underpainting by adding more to the foundation that you have down. So because that area is blurred, I'm trying to not get those sharp edges. So you want to soften those edges up as you go. So I have, what I've done is you can see that it's got a sort of border around it, but I have cut another piece of paper where I've cut the square out, and that's just so that it kind of looks clean in this video. It's so that you don't see the rest of the worksheet with different things sticking out. This at least keeps the focus on that little window that I created. So that is why it is like that. Because I am drawing directly on the worksheet, but I don't want the rest of the worksheet to poke out and, yeah, and interfere. So I know that on the right side there's pretty much no white. There's lots of areas of grey, but there's no white. So that's why I'm coming in with my very, very light, like bluish grey colours, and with my greys, and I'm filling in those areas that don't have white in there. So just using light pencils. Make sure when you have a look at your reference photos, notice that there's not much white. Very rarely is there white. The whitest areas that you will find are the real highlighted areas. So like in the eye, for instance, there will be one little tiny highlight which will be pure white, and that's usually the light reflecting in the eye. Just those really subtle highlights are the only things that will be pure white. The rest of it will be different tones of grays and very light colors, maybe even blues. If you look at the tutorial that I did on how to draw white fur, not much of it was white. Like it was a very white dog that I drew, but I didn't use that much white. Yes, I did use white over the last, as the last layer to just enhance the different directions of fur and stuff, but very little of it is actually stark white. So don't leave areas white. The more grays and values you add, the more depth it's going to give something, and the more realistic it's going to make a drawing look. So now I'm using my wax pencil to enhance the white on the nose there, so you'll see that it's going to pop out a little bit better. And comparing my drawing to my reference photo, the nose needs to be a fair bit darker on the right side, so I'm just making sure that I do that. Random little like scribbles almost on top of the nose, so that's also gonna give you the illusion that there's different pieces of hair going all sorts of directions. So scribbles come in handy. And then I use that like reddish color in the nose, so I'm making sure to add that to surrounding areas that I feel needed. So above that eye, you can see there's a lot of reddish and pinkish areas with the shadow or the reflection over there. So now I'm just blending with the solvent. My brush was way too wet over there. Do not have your brush that wet. I did dry it off a lot and try to almost pick it up again with the brush, and I kept dabbing all the excess off. So you barely want anything on there. It's like you have to keep blending in a tiny little area for ages before it starts mushing to a smoothness. Then you know you have the right amount. But if it just, if you can see it, it's wet and it shines like it did when I first put it on, then it's too much. It needs to be so little on your brush. Like, you don't even have to dip it in the solvent that much. You want to use the brush until it's absolutely completely dry before you dip it in, and then you dab as much of it off on a piece of cloth as you can as well. It must be very, very slightly damp. So there again, I had it too wet. I kept having to dry it off. But it turned out okay because I want that eye to be very soft. I don't want it to have hard edges. Right now, the eye's got, it looks like it's got a harsh line. So I'm gonna be using my pinks to blend that out a bit more. So you'll notice that when you blend with your solvent over the lines that you've etched, the color's gonna go in there. But that's okay, because we are gonna go over it again later on. But because it's etched in the paper, it still physically has a texture, so it's easy to work on that texture with your lighter pencils later on and bring it all out again. So blending in the nose, and this is going to make it look, bring those shadows really well together, all the shaded areas. Blending the eye. I made the eye way too dark, but I'm gonna make it lighter later on. That eye is a lot bigger than the other eye, which is okay, because that's the way it is in the reference photo. Now I'm going into my white Luminance pencil because I want that area to be lighter. I want it to be whiter, and that's why I keep working on it. Because if you look at the reference photo, that area is just a white little blur. And then adding the white wax base pencils to other areas that need to be white. So on top of that eye, I put way too much gray. So I'm just gonna sort of burnish that with my white to get it a lot lighter and softer. The same with the inside of the eye. And then I'm also gonna go over some of my etched highlight areas too. So that's what's nice about layering with solvents, is you can go over it again afterwards and work out those lighter layers with the wax base pencils. So I noticed that there was a piece of hair that kind of curved over like that, so that's what I added in there now. And then I'm going to lighten up some of those blurry bits that are too dark. So now I'm using my Caran d'Ache Luminance White. You can use your Prismacolor White as well. And I am forming those little dots. So I'm enhancing over the textured areas. I'm going to still put those highlighted little dots, and that is creating a texture. So look, the nose is already getting a bit more of a texture. I noticed that there's more shadow in the area around next to the nose there, so I made sure to add more grays. And I'm going over with my white, going in the direction, always going in the right direction of the furs, and creating that. So now I'm going over the dark, some of the dark areas with random little strands. And look at how that nose, the hairs around the nose are starting to give you an idea of overlap and depth. That is what we want. That's what adds to the realism. So now I'm going over the etched lines with my Luminance White, and this is gonna enhance those hairs more, give it more of a texture, and really make them pop out. because that's going to balance the pink out a bit more, and it's going to move that warmish feeling to the other side as well, and that's just going to complement the gray by adding the purple over it. Now, looking at my reference photo, I noticed that I needed to add way more pink, so I'm just taking note of that and adding that. Adding more purple next to the gray so that the gray and the purple mix well with the surrounding pink areas. Now I'm coming in with like a salmon color and also balancing it so it's not too pink but it's not too orange either, so it's a good little in between note to add into those colors. So using the tiny bit of whatever I have left on my brush, and I'm going to soften the outer edges of the eye so that it doesn't look as harsh. I want it to move to the back, to blur to the back like the rest of it. So there's a constant buildup of layers, like you just keep working areas, keep working and keep adding those colors, keep blending, keep working, keep adding. And those colors blend together over time, and you see that it just adds to the realism. The more you layer, the more you focus on different areas. It's not just a matter of finding a color and putting that color in the right area. You need to blend it with the surrounding colors. You need to make sure you pay extra attention to your reference so you know what other areas to put it in, because you're not just going to have an image that's got warm colors one side, cool colors the other side, and none of those colors are mixing on the other sides, because then it won't balance. It will just look, it just doesn't look right. Whatever colors you have in the main subject is going to be reflected in the background, and the same the other way around. You're not going to have a completely green background but have no green in the main subject, because then it will look like you've just copied and pasted an image on top of a green background. That's why balance is so good. You need to incorporate all surrounding colors in your main subject, and that's going to make it balance real nice. So coming in again with my white wax base pencil, and I'm going to create more of a texture on the nose. Go over those edge bits a bit better and make them a little more rounded, because I found that I etched it a little more of a scribble than the round little specks that you have on the nose. So I'm just making sure I enhance that with my wax base pencil. And that's what's so nice about the wax base pencil when you're layering using this sort of process, is once you layer, you can go over your darker colors with your lighter wax base pencils. You can't unfortunately do that with your polychromos pencils, but Prismas work perfectly in that sense. As long as you haven't overdone the layers and it's not thick with wax bloom, then you can put those lighter colors on top, no problem. Adding more shadows between the hair, that's what's also another nice thing, is that because we have so much of the white wax in that hair already, it's easy to kind of just work between it. You can go over that white and it won't stick to it, because the white's already pushed into the paper, so you're not worried about the dark shadows going over. So the more you put your dark pencil over it, the more it's just going to look like it's actually in the back of the highlighted hairs. It's creating that depth and that shadow. Blending again with barely anything on my brush, you can see that I'm taking my time with the blend. Adding more shadow to the nose. Constant working, just keep working on all the areas. Keep looking at your reference photo, keep building it up. Adding some blues with the grays, same concept as the purple. The blues just make the grays look softer, the purple makes the grays look softer. The purple blends very well with the pinks, so that's just what's forming the balance in this picture. So this is the Jelly Roll pen. This is another thing that you can do to add highlights, very, very wide highlights to something, because it's almost like a pen that's like got acrylic paint in it, I think. I don't know what's in there, but it leaves very wide little highlights. So you can, those tiny little hairs on top of the nose is perfect for that. Creating the real white little specks on the nose is perfect for that. Putting that highlight in the eye, if you're drawing eyes, you can, it's very good for that if you want to just enhance that highlight. Or if you've got like the real wet areas within an eye, you can add highlights that way as well. Okay, moving on to the dog. Okay, so this one I'm doing a little bit different to the cat. So I'm actually going to do my wax layer of white first for my highlights instead of the etching method. Now, when I chased the outline down onto the paper, I did etch a little bit over the top, but I didn't etch again on the actual drawing paper to enhance the etches. So I decided that I would use my white wax pencil as my main way of getting my white highlights, so I can show you guys how to do that. So starting off with a dog's nose, usually I like starting off with the nostrils because that just is a good starting point to work off of. So it just helps create the shapes that you want, and it's easier to flow from there with the in-between shapes. So now I'm going to get the real easy stuff down first. So I'm going to do the sort of blurred background of the skin next to the snout and towards the eyes. So this looks like a ridgeback nose because it looks like the nose of one of my girls, but it's not, it's just a picture that I found because I like the pink sort of spots in the nose, so I thought that would be very good to show you guys. And yes, I like the hair, the soft fur around the nose too. I wonder where they are. Taylor! Honey! I don't know what I'd do without my puppies. Hey, what would mommy do without you? Where's your sister? Okay, moving on. I'm using a sort of, also a cold dark gray to softly fill in the dark areas around the nose. Not worrying about details. The first few layers, and never worry about the details. There's no point in fussing about the details. You just want to block the colors down. Just it makes it easier to work from an underpainting. So I would call this the hardest part, not the detailing. The hardest part to drawing is getting the underpainting done, where all you need to worry about instead of details is just worry about the values. You want to get your darks and your lights in, and you want to know exactly where to locate the darks and the lights in every area of your drawing, and then that is what's going to make the rest of it much easier. So I'm just making sure to always work in the right direction. So that's what I'm doing now, trying to fill in the hairs, but just because I'm working in the right direction, it's automatically giving it the illusion of fur or hair. So again, just trying to identify where that darker patches on top of the nose, separate to the highlighted areas on top of the nose. I want to take note of my reference photo and make very sure that I am not going in the wrong areas. So that's why the underpainting is important, and you should take your time with that, because once you've established those values and areas in your underpainting, that's what you're going to keep building up from. So if you get that wrong, then it's going to end up looking wrong in the end. So I'm using a very light bluish grey, and that's what I'm putting on the areas that have a sort of wet look on the nose, so the highlighted areas that are a little more moist. So yeah, as you can see, I go over with a little bit of a darker pencil. You can see some of the areas that I did etch onto the paper. It's forming a little bit of a texture. Just a tip, when you are creating a black area, so that bottom lip there is very, very black, but I still put the other colors in there. I'll still put the grays and the blues and things in there, all the purples, just so that it's, even though you might not think that you can see it, it does balance it out. Instead of making it completely black, also add your other colors in there, and that's just going to add balance to your drawing. It's not just going to be black. So that's what you want to do. Also, it's good to do your backgrounds first when you're doing something. So it just makes it easier. If you're doing something that's furry or hairy, it's difficult to get the background in later, because that means you're gonna have to go in between those little furs, little pieces of hair and things that are sticking out. And it's much harder to do it the other way around. If you do a background first, you don't have to worry about that. And then you do your foreground, and then it's easy for you to put the hairs over the background. And then it's not gonna look strange. So I'm adding purples. I like my very dark purples. I want to add into the nose area. So I'm gonna have grays, I'm gonna have purples, I'm gonna have black, I'm gonna have pinkish sort of colors. But yeah, the purple is just gonna make it look really good. And even though it looks so plain and flat and you can see the texture of the paper and everything, don't worry about it, because the minute you put that solver down, those colors are gonna pop, and then it's gonna just make it easy to build up from there. But you want to get your underpainting done properly before you go ahead and blend it with the solvent, and it's gonna make it that much easier. So don't worry about the rough crayon texture look in the beginning, because now that we're blending with the solvent, you're gonna see exactly how those purples are a very useful color. You can see why when I blend, and it's gonna add so much to it. I really love it already. It's so much fun blending with a solvent, because of the color that comes out, and because it just makes it look so smooth, and it's almost like you're going from a crayon drawing to a realistic thing. So it's nice watching that transition sort of come to life. Just keep blending. Don't have your brush too wet. Also blend in the right directions. And you are gonna see exactly why I'm saying that the underpainting is so important, because the minute you blend with a solvent, so this is us doing the final stage of the underpainting. And all the most important things are established right there. You can see where the darkest values are. You can see which areas need to be worked on and enhanced. Well, all of it does, but you can see exactly where you are. When you look at your reference photo and when you go to your drawing to put the details down, you know exactly where to go, because you've established that already in your underpainting. So Natalie, let me know if that makes sense to you, or if you want me to go through the process of underpainting even more. So that's it, that's the underpainting. Now we are gonna start with the detail work and start pushing on from there and creating the realism that we're aiming for. Please don't mind me having coffee while watching a movie and talking through it. I'm using blues and purples here, so this is good. Like, I don't want the nose to be dark. If you pay extra attention to the reference photo, you can see that those areas sort of have a purplish color. So if something has a purplish color, then you're going to incorporate your blues and your pinks and your purples, and you're just going to work on that. It would have been easy to just make it gray, but then it doesn't add that color. It doesn't make it look right. But the more you draw and the more you focus on your reference photos, the more you pick up on colors that you didn't think were there, if that makes any sense. So I'm adding blue here on top of the nose, indigo blue in the fur even, and I'll be adding purple in the fur as well. And that's just gonna make those grays a little more colorful. It's not just gonna be flat gray. It's gonna be blues and purples and grays to form that shadow. And when you look at it at the end, you're gonna think that it's just gray, but it's not. It's gonna form a balance, because you've incorporated the surrounding colors into it as well. So yes, I know I'm sounding very, very repetitive, but once you understand it, it starts becoming flow, it starts becoming easy, and you will just know what I mean as you go. So here I am using a light, I think a cool gray Prismacolor, and look how nice it's sitting on top of the colors. Like, I love Prismacolor pencils. I just love how they layer. It's just so nice. And because we're using purples and blues, you want to use a cool gray like that, not a warm gray. So adding some pinks, and now it's reds. And remember, you also want to add some of these reds in the actual nose. You want to take the surrounding colors and incorporate them into your main subject to give it a balance. So right now I'm just going to go and blend everything in again, having very little on my brush. Now you'll find when you blend all the white and the grays that it starts to sit on your brush and move around. So just wipe your brush again off on a towel or a piece of tissue paper or something, and then continue on. But even if you keep mushing those lighter colors around, it doesn't matter, because you can just go in and darken it up. But now you can see with the blending how the blues, the purples, and the grays are just mushing and blending so beautifully together. It's giving it such a variety of color. And it's gonna add so much to it later on. So using my Luminance White, I'm just gonna enhance a little bit of the lighter area in the fur over here, because I felt like I went a little bit too dark. But that's the nice thing about using your wax-based pencils after you've used solvent, is that it will sit on top. I struggled with this area. It's like I didn't get the shaping in that right, and I just kept going over it, and eventually I was like, ugh. So I do still get that. I do still get silly little simple areas that I just struggle with, and that's a normal thing. So So if you don't want to, if you want to just soften something, especially if it's a blurry area, just use a piece of tissue paper. You don't have to dunk it in solvent or anything, because it's got a few layers already, so it will soften it up anyways. And the tissue will lift a lot of that off, so it does give it a blurry sort of smooth look. So now you can see I'm working this area again, and the way it looked before was fine, but I had to go and add more. So sometimes you can overdo areas, and sometimes you must just let it go. So that tiny little patch there is just one that I just kept working on, and eventually I decided, okay, just move on to the rest. Okay, I don't know what I was doing there. I think I was fiddling with my iPad. I like to watch Netflix and that while I draw, but lately I just have been having so much trouble with Netflix. And then I end up spending more time trying to figure out what to watch or what to listen to than getting into my drawing. Okay, so enhancing the blues and the purples on the nose. This time I'm going into smaller details, so I'm gonna focus on areas that have specific sorts of shadows, and I'm gonna focus on the shapes and the texture and the value. And just keep working on it. So some of you might be interested in knowing that we might be moving to the East Coast, which is really exciting. And my partner's family, he's got a massive Italian family, and they all have their own big farms, and they live in these in this beautiful town inland, and it's so nice there, and I would adore living there. Before I carry on with that, I'll just explain what I'm doing here. So I am using my light pink Prismacolor pencil, and I am creating those dots on the nose to give you the look of the texture. And look at that already, it's starting to look textured. It's having those spots. So this is, without using an etching tool, this is how you get it right. This is where you use your light wax based pencils as final layers to your nose. So now I'm coming in with an even lighter one to sort of create the highlighted pieces on the little circles on the nose to give it more depth and to give it more of a sort of structure. Also making sure that I don't make every shape exactly the same, so that it looks, you know, it looks different. It's not gonna look weird, because every spot doesn't look the same. So make sure that you don't try and make it the same. So using my light blue pencil, I'm creating more of that. That's how I'm creating the moist look on the nose. And then I'm coming in with a bit of black. Now I probably shouldn't have used the black. I should have used the purple for this, because the black is just too harsh to go around those areas on the nose. So I think I do try and soften it a bit with the solvent, but if you are going to try this, don't put the black around those areas, rather put your purple around it, because the black was just a bit too harsh. So using my white luminance, I'm gonna focus a little more on those little highlights on the nose. You will notice that the spots on the nose that I created on my drawing are a fair bit bigger than the ones in my reference photo. So if you are really fussy about it, then make it even smaller. But I wasn't gonna make it super, super tiny, because it is a small drawing, so the points of my pencil aren't that tiny, so it just makes it easier to make the spots a bit bigger, but it still has a realistic look, so I wasn't too worried about it. I'm not being as tiny as the ones in the reference photo, but I could have made it smaller if I wanted to. So now I'm using my dark cool gray pencil, and I'm creating those patchy bits in the hair. So if you look at the reference photo, you'll see that there are some darker areas that almost look spotty. They look patchy. So I'm working on that now with this pencil. It's just gonna make it look really good. And the more you work on these areas, the softer it's gonna start looking. So yes, as I was saying with my partner's family, he's got a very big Italian family. They all have this beautiful land and these beautiful areas, and we aren't the kind of couple that want to go out partying every weekend. Like, both of us are really content. We like being at home and we like being around family and that, and we know that it's just going to be so nice if we can get there. My poor partner has to spend 3 hours in traffic every day just so that he can get to work and back, and it's just killing him. The travel is just ridiculous, and the city life is too busy and everything for us. We like the quiet, and we can get a nice we can get some nice areas there with such a nice big land, and the dogs would love it, because right now our backyard is so small that they don't really have room to really run around. So I think that is a very strong possibility that that's going to happen, so just bear that in mind. But I'll let you know when we know. We'll only really find out or know for sure if we're going to go by the end of this month, and then we'll see what happens. Okay, so I've added pinks and I've added purples, and now I'm coming in with a light gray. I think it's my 10% gray, and this is what I'm going to use as my lighter areas of fur. So look at that, automatically the fur is starting to come to life, and those are sort of my highlights that I'm going to use. So I'm not going to use a white, I'm using this gray to create those highlights on top of the dark area, and it's going to soften it up, and it's going to make it look soft and furry, which is what we want. And then those areas that are sort of the whiskery kind of areas that are blurry going over the bottom lip area is what I'm creating there. And it's just so easy and to go over it. When you layer like this, it just makes it really easy for the prismas to go over in highlights. And I love the look. It's so satisfying as well, being able to get those light highlights over the top. And when you do your final layer, it's like, wow, I love it. And then you can go and add the darkest of dark areas, and that's just gonna really enhance it more. And that's the dog. Okay, so straight away, looking at this drawing, you can see those edge lines. If you look carefully, you can see that I've etched those little whiskers out everywhere. And I'm going to start with the background first. So, yep, that was a prisma breaking. And I couldn't get it sharpened fully, so I just decided to not bother too much. But yeah, so adding the greens, adding I think it was a dark gray over the dark green, and building up those colors. So taking note, there's sort of very different sorts of shapes in the background, and they have very soft edges because they're blurred. So I just take note of that. Don't have any very straight lines or anything, just keep it really soft and gentle and keep going. And the more I go over these areas, the more you're going to see those whiskers pop out. So that is the best part about the etching tool. I really love it so much, and I use it all the time. Building it up more and more and more, you just get such a satisfaction out of it. I don't know if you do. I love it. I love going over it with pencil and being like, yep, they are just popping out nice and white, just the way I want it to. So again, just taking note of all the colors, focusing on my reference, and building it up layer by layer. This is the underpainting. So I'm just going to keep it light and simple. I am going to finish the background properly before, excuse me, I do the rest of the horse. So the underpainting of the horse and the underpainting of the background obviously isn't going to happen at the same time. So that piece of wood that's behind the horse's muzzle has got a lot of blues in it, so it's like bluish grey. So I just want to make sure that I incorporate those colours into that. It's not as green as the rest of the background, although if you look carefully there are parts of it that have a greenish sort of colour. So now I'm putting blue in, and you can see how the blue is standing out separate to the green. You want that to balance, and the way you balance that is by adding a little over them with the white wax base pencil straight after etching. It's gonna cover those areas, but I want those hairs to be so subtle. I'm not worried about that because I'm gonna come in later with my white wax base pencils and go over those etched areas again when I finish my layers, and then it will pop them back out again anyways. So right now I'm not too worried about the whiskers. I just want to work on my background and get it really soft and blurry and smoothed in. You can try and work around the whiskers if you want, if you don't want to get the solvent in there, but I would say don't worry about it. It kind of does blend the whiskers in with the background a little better, and it does make it a little more subtle instead of thick and harsh. So don't worry about your background going over it, because we are definitely going to fix that later. So you can see I'm working those areas a fair bit. I hardly have any solvent on my brush, so that's why I just keep pushing on those areas, mixing them together, getting them nice and blurry. So now I'm coming in with my white wax base pencil and I'm going over those whiskers again. So look how that pops out. So it's easy for you to fix that. So don't worry if your solvent goes into your etched pieces, because it's fixable. And that looks very subtle and soft. It doesn't look too harsh and it just makes it easier. So now that I'm going over it with my second layer, it's okay if I go over them again, because I put white wax down for the whiskers, the color's not going to go over there when I blend. It's still going to stick out, so I'm not worried about the color going over. I'd encourage you to actually try that. Draw a little square with your white wax base pencil, and then draw another square around it, and color that entire square in, and see how white the area stays with the wax base pencil with you putting another color over it. And then once you know exactly how that white wax base pencil works, it comes in useful in many areas. You'll see that white wax, once it's down, it's not that easy to get color over it unless you're using a firm hand. So that's why it's good to get those things down first. So I'm just blending a bit more. There's a few more colors and some areas need to be a little bit more darker and that, so I'm just making sure that I add them in. And just keep working those layers. I'm sure you guys have noticed that I do not list the colors in that I use. And I'm sure if you watch the videos, you will see why. Because I changed the colors so many times that if I had to try and take note of every single color, I would be spending way too much time trying to list the colors down every time. So the more you draw, the more you get familiar with the colors, and the more you will get confident in how you pick them. Just because this is a tutorial doesn't mean you have to get the same colors exactly the same as mine. So coming in with my blue, just to enhance that blue a bit more in there. And then coming in with the grays with the darker shadows of that area. I'm quite happy with how the bottom of the bottom bit turned out with the blurred bits. So now I'm just gonna focus on the wood. And then once that's done, I can start focusing on the horse muzzle. Adding a little bit of purple and then gray. I used a lot of that gray in the green below, so that will also help sort of balance that area out a bit more. And you can see that I blended over that, but those whiskers stayed white with a wax pencil, so it wasn't any need to worry. And they're subtle and soft, and they don't look so harsh, and that's what we want. And then when you finish those background layers, you can just come in with your white wax pencil and you can enhance your whiskers. Okay, so now I get to start on the horse. So I'm doing this right top corner first, because it's the darkest area and it's quite a simple area. And now you can see why it's useful to do the background first, because now when you do the foreground, you can just put those hairs straight over the background. So those other little dark lines I just drew are in the whiskers. So you'll notice that the whiskers aren't completely white. A lot of them have some darker areas, so that's just what I added there. And now I'm just using my black pencil to kind of point out the darkest areas of the muzzle and the spots. And this is the underpainting of the horse muzzle that I'm drawing now. And this is what's going to help me locate different areas properly. So I'm going to work on the values, and I'm going to work on the darkest compared to the lightest, and make sure I know exactly where to work from once the underpainting is done. So with something like this, you want to take note of those spots and draw them the same as what it is on the horse, especially if you're going to do a commission, because those are unique features to that horse. So if you're doing a commission and there's unique features to it, you want to always add those features, because those features make that horse identifiable, if I can put it that way, makes them unique. So you want to always add that. When you're doing commissions of people though, and someone might have a mole or a wart or a mark on them, always ask them first if they'd like you to not include that in the drawing. Some people aren't worried about it because they know that that's what makes them them, but other people would prefer not to have it. So when it's people, make sure you ask. And also another tip, when you're drawing a dog as a commission, and it has a collar on, ask the owner if they want you to draw the collar as well, because a lot of the time the drawing will actually look better if the dog doesn't have a collar. So just ask them about that. And also, before you go ahead and draw a commission, make sure that you look at everything on the photograph. And if there's something that doesn't look right, point it out. Ask the person that's commissioning you to do the drawing if you can change something, or if you can crop something in a certain way, or if you can cut something out and not include it, or if you can add something maybe. So, but make sure you confirm those things before you go ahead with the drawing. You want the client to know exactly what to expect every step of the way. Okay, so with this underpainting, I've added pinks, I've added purples, I'm adding this really light gray, and this is helping me locate different areas. You can see that I've done the spots in the nose. I'm creating a sort of textured look on this area now, and that's just gonna help build form and texture later on, and just keep building up those values. I really like this gray a lot because it's almost got like a bluish tinge to it. It's nice. So now I'm coming in with a white sort of highlight. So those areas that are going to have the lightest bits, I'm just gently putting down the white luminance. So I'm sure you guys are already feeling if you've watched all of this already, you're already starting to feel very confident about your approach in drawing this area of these animals and how it works, or the process of the underlayering and doing a background before you do the foreground kind of thing. So this is going to give you a lot more confidence to just go ahead and start, because I know sometimes, especially as a beginner, it can be quite daunting looking at an entire picture and you're like, where do I start? I don't understand. Okay, I've decided I'm going to start on the nose, but how exactly do I get that started? And the same with the eyes. Usually, I think most people start with the eyes, because once you have the eyes right, it automatically brings something to life and it gives you the ability to work around it. I find that it is easier to do the eyes first anyways. So before I'm layering this with solvent, I'm coming in with my white luminance and enhancing those whiskers first, because I know if I go over that with solvent before I put the white wax base pencil down, it's going to go into those indents. So just keep that in mind. So now I'm just blending very softly, going to blend everything. And I'm not worried about the whiskers because they're already down. They're already there. They already have the wax on it. So I'm not worried about them. And it's so easy, it's so nice to not fuss about that, because you get that done before anything else and it makes it easier than doing that last. So now that I'm blending, you're gonna see the colors are gonna start to pop out. You're gonna see the pinks and the purples that I've added to it much easier. And it's gonna just turn out really nice. So you can see how the tiniest bit that I have on my brush, so it's taking a while to blend, but I want it to be really soft and I don't want too much solvent on there. Sorry, I keep leaning back and back and back. And then eventually I'm going to disappear out of the picture. And then again, I'm just going to keep building up my layers. I'm going to keep paying attention to my reference. I'm going to keep working those colors in, and then right in the end is when I'm going to do the really dark colors. So doing all the mid-tones and the main colors first and worrying about the darker tones much later. So this one actually went a lot quicker than the other two. I don't know if I was just in the zone or what it was, but this one turned out really good. It's not that hard to draw. Once you see the approach to it like this, you realize that it's actually not that difficult, and it's the whole concept just, I don't know, works. It starts coming out pretty good. So now I'm working on a bit of the darker values, making sure I add more pink in the nose because right now it feels like it looks too blue. Constantly building it up and working it all out. So it took me to do all three of these, it took me 5.5 hours, which is not too bad. I'm very happy with that sort of result. And they all have the complete block filled in. It's not just the noses or the muzzles or the snouts or whatever that I drew. But incorporating the background gives you guys a good idea or a good sense of where to start. So here I'm adding the greens because I know that there's greens at the bottom. You want to add the greens in the main subject. So whatever colors are in the background, you want to subtly incorporate those colors into your main subject as well. So just working a little more on the details, adding some blues instead of grays to those spots on the nose, using blues to enhance those shadows and build it up more. And then those spots, because I felt that they were too dark, you can use a lighter Prismacolor pencil and you can just lighten them up a bit. And now I'm going to blend gently, get it all smoothed out really well. And it's starting to look quite nice. I'm very happy with how it's starting to turn out. And remember, sometimes get up, take a step back, have a good look. And you'll find that when you actually take a step back, you notice more things. So now I'm just enhancing some things with my white pencil. Just adding a bit more of a texture look on some areas, and that was it. So I just took a very good photo with my DSLR camera, and you should be able to look at the comparisons of all of them together right here. So obviously they're not exactly the same as the reference photos, but they're really close. It's enough to call it realistic. It's enough to call it close. It looks real, it looks textured, it looks nice, and that's what you want in your drawings. And the more you draw, the better you get. And you just keep improving, keep improving, keep improving. You don't get to a point where you are just perfect. There's always a time to grow. There's always things to improve and learn. So it will just keep getting better and better and better the more you do it. So I thank you guys for watching this tutorial. You were probably sick of listening to my voice and looking at my face, but I really hope you find this useful. And the next tutorial is going to be pretty cool. It'll probably be a bit quicker than this. I won't be talking this much because it's just working on shine. And that tutorial is going to be more about, it will be easier to show you than to explain it kind of tutorial. So we'll see how that all works out. So thank you for watching, and I will see you guys next week. Bye.